colors of the jungle all around us. Amazing plants and animals surround us.
Good morning. Happy Father's Day. Woo, go dads. I'm not biased. But we are so glad you're here. And, you know, we want to make sure we truly want to celebrate all the biological fathers, but we want to celebrate all the men because you guys have all been fathers, if not to anyone else in this world, to me. And I cannot tell you how much I appreciate that. And we thank you. We thank God for each of you. We pray you have a great day. I'm going to say what I said in early church. Thank you for choosing church over an early tea time or an early fish or a late. I guess you could have gone fishing this morning and came in. But by being at church, I'm not a prophet. But I feel God is going to bless you when you go play golf today. And then if you go fishing this evening, it might be extra good. But don't be mad if it's not. But I feel it's going to be that way. So thank you for being here with us this morning. If you're a guest, man, we appreciate it. I know we have some families and some of our vacation Bible schoolers that are here. We thank you for coming and worshiping with us. If this is your first time to be at church here, we have a gift for you back at our table, our welcoming table out in the narthex, which is that room just right out there. We'd love to give you a gift and just say thank you for being here with us. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to stop. All the announcements are in the bulletin, but I want to stress one. Directory pictures start this week, and that is open to anyone who's part of the church. You don't have to be a member or whatever, but if this is your church, be part of those. You can still sign up. If you are like several people who have forgotten when they signed up for their directory picture and have called the office this week, you can continue to do that. But also, you can just stop by the table out in the narthex where two wonderful, amazing ladies are working, and they can tell you when your picture is. If you're like me, it's probably, if you've forgotten, it's probably Tuesday, so don't wait too long to check on that, okay? All right, so do that. Other announcements you can read. We want to thank you for allowing us a little flexibility today as we celebrate our vacation Bible school. It was amazing, but we'll talk about that a little more in a second. On that's it for these. So we have a special introit to prepare our hearts for worship this morning.
Thank you. Can everyone stand, please, and join us
in worship?
When we believe in God's word,
it gives us the guidance we need to know how to live.
Jesus' death and resurrection makes it possible
for each person to experience God's love forever.
God's love is so amazing
that it motivates us to love Him in return and pass His love on to others.
No matter what circumstances we are in,
we can pray to God and He will hear our prayers and help us experience His goodness.
God has made us in wonderful ways
so that we can love Him by serving others. Thanks be to God.
Let's pass the peace God has for each of us this morning. And as you're seated, I'd like to invite up all the children, if there are any left, to come up for a special children's time with Miss Sarah. Come on up, children.
Here this morning, and we have our characters from the rainforest here with us as well. Kate and Sean are our forest ranger, and Loritza. I'm still not gonna get it right this week, kids. So we had a great week at VBS, didn't we? And I'm so proud of each and every one of you and of the volunteers. Just once again, I want to say a great thank you to every single one that came and devoted your time. So we had a great week. It was very busy, and I'm sure you're very tired, but I think it made a very good impact on our children as well. So, okay, today is a very special day as well. What's today? Father's Day! Wow, it's VBS Sunday and Father's Day on the same day. That's so cool. Did you do anything special for your fathers this morning? Anything? You did? Did you give him a gift?
I called my grandpa.
You called your grandpa? That was good. So sometimes our grandpas can be our fathers too. What'd you do?
I called my grandpa.
You called your grandpa too? Oh, good. Because our grandpas can be our fathers as well and our uncles. You gave him a sucker? You did. You listened to me and gave him a sucker. I told them they had to give their candy to their dad this morning at the first service. So, well, today, you know what? I have a mystery to solve. I know one of your dads, and I have all of the things that make him special written on the cards. Would y'all like to play a game and solve a mystery? To see whose dad I'm talking about? All right, let's see if we can figure it out. What's this? An R, and it stands for ready. And this dad that I'm talking about is always ready. He's always ready to be there for you no matter what and take care of you. And even if he's busy, he'll still be ready to help you with whatever you need. So this is a really nice dad. What's this letter? E. And that stands for energetic. And this dad has all sorts of energy. Even if it's 2 a.m, he'll get up and he'll do whatever you need him to do to help you. So that's a cool dad. And an H. Everybody see the H? Kind of backwards here. Helpful. This dad will do whatever he can, night or day, to make sure that you get everything you need when you ask him. All you have to do is ask. And he will try to help you whenever he can, no matter what time or what day it is. And the next letter is T. And T stands for teacher. This dad teaches us right from wrong, good from bad. And he might even punish us when we don't do what we're supposed to do. But he still loves us all the time. And an A. That stands for attentive. Even if he's busy and he's working on something else, he drops everything right there to say, no, I'm going to listen to you because you're more important than anything I'm working on. So I don't care. You have my full attention all the time. And the last letter is an F, and it stands for forgiving. This dad will forgive you of anything that you do wrong, no matter how bad it is, no matter what you do, he will always forgive you. And he promises to forgive you, and that's what he says he will do. So this is the dad that I'm talking about today. So who thinks that this is their dad? Who thinks this is the dad? No one? All righty then. We might have a problem. Okay. Well, that's actually a good thing because I'm not talking about our earthly fathers or grandfathers or uncles. I'm talking about, who am I talking about, Caleb?
God.
God. I'm talking about our Heavenly Father God because He can provide us for so many things that our earthly fathers can't. But that's the way He created it to be because He teaches our earthly fathers how they need to act and behave and guides them on how to be good fathers to us. But their parenting comes from God, because He's our number one Father, and He will always take care of us and give us everything we need 24/7 as long as we ask. Isn't that cool? To know you have two fathers. That's pretty awesome, isn't it? Father God and your earthly God. So today, when you get candy, I'm going to give you 2 pieces, and one goes to your father to tell him Happy Father's Day, okay? Or your grandfather, or your uncle, or whoever is a father figure in your life. You ready to pray? But we can get going and get singing some more? Dear God, thank you so much for allowing these children to be up here this morning and to get to church safely. We thank you for the impact you have on all of our fathers, not just today, but year-round. And we thank you for the VBS kids who came today to sing with us and that were here last week. We pray that everyone gets home safely today and that they get to celebrate a day for just their dads. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, can y'all hang out just a little while longer? All right, you're doing great. Isn't this, okay, no offense to the adult choir, which is excellent and awesome, but is this not the greatest choir ever today? We're really going to be blessed by them in just a second. So as the ushers come forward, would you bow and pray with me? Almighty God, you have poured out your blessings on us. You have given us so much. Now we give back to you out of the blessings of our lives. We thank you, God, that you have blessed each of us so much that we can give and allow so many children from our community to come and be part of this at no cost. We thank you, God, for the blessings. And now we ask that you take these gifts and tithes and offerings and use them to share your love with everyone. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Hey, would y'all do me a favor real quick? Would y'all sit down? We're going to celebrate Vacation Bible School. Did y'all have a good time?
Yes.
Were you glad we got to do this?
Yes.
We are so glad you got to come. Watch this. I want to show you something cool, okay? Watch this. If you're an adult and you helped in some way in Vacation Bible School, would you stand up? Isn't that amazing? Look how many people helped you guys. What do y'all want to say thank you for them? Can y'all give them a big thank you? That was as good of a clap as it was in early church this morning for fathers, wasn't it? But we do appreciate it, and we know, I mean, there were so many more youth and adults who came and volunteered this week. It was amazing. I think we were somewhere around 220 total, maybe a little more, throughout the week of kids from all over our community. We thank you. If you guys knew what we did to the sanctuary, I'm not sure you would let this happen, but thank you. It was awesome. And we know that children grew closer to God, which is what this is all about. So for all of you who helped, for all of you who represent all the children that were here, I say thanks be to God. Would you join me? Thanks be to God. Amen. All right. If y'all want to go sit with your parents, go sit with your parents. Or if you want to go to kids' church, right down there. But I would recommend doing what your mommy and daddy tell you to do. I want to say a special thank you. Sorry, Ellen. Special thank you to Sarah, to Donna, and to Marcia, who are not here, who went to the beach. They had all the rainforest they could handle, but they were our leaders, and we were so blessed to have them, and they did an incredible job. So thank you for them.
Absolutely. Thank you. If you hear anyone say, you know, it was a zoo up here, they're laughing because it really was. The Austin Zoo came and brought a bunch of animals that were up here. We had a tortoise. I got a great picture of Darby with the tortoise. Where'd Darby go? Sean with the tortoise. And a python. We didn't let it down, don't worry. A skink. I didn't know what a skink was. Not sure I still know what a skink is. Cockroach, koala, a cockatoo. It was a zoo, a rainforest zoo. So we have a lot of people to thank today. So on that note, let us begin our time of prayer with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you so much for all of these persons who have helped make a difference in the lives of these children for 1 week of their summer. And oh God, we've been given an opportunity to do so much more. To continue to plant seeds in the life of children, to help them understand how precious they are and how much you love them. And I think sometimes in our world, oh God, we hear so many things that are contrary to that. And Lord, I remember more than once hearing someone at Vacation Bible School just say, Jesus loves you. And if these children walk away with nothing more than that and the memory of a cockatoo, I'm thankful. We ask, oh God, that you be with every person who helped, but Lord, be with those who were unable to help for a lot of different reasons, and be with those who volunteered and have had to go away and have a vacation now, and I know of at least three who are now resting somewhere. It's a tiring week, but Lord, it was a good week. And we owe that to you. Thank you, oh God. We also know that as we worship here this morning, we have friends and members who are in hospitals today. We know that Bud Whitehead is in the hospital right now. We also know that Kevin Ludlam is still back at MD Anderson. Lord, place your healing hand upon those two gentlemen and upon their families. And all of those, oh God, who are back and forth, in and out of the hospital, seeing doctors, searching for answers that the great physician must provide. We call upon you, O God. We pray for those, oh God, who are in nursing homes this morning or assisted living facilities or who are confined to their home because of illness. We pray, oh God, and we give thanks for all of our first responders, those who care for us in times of great need. We ask, oh God, that you be with those who struggle under the burden of some form of addiction, that it may be lifted. We thank you, Lord, for those who lead us and our nation, our state, our county. We pray, oh God, that you will be with those in elected office and help them to act in a way that reflects your love in everything they do. And Lord, that will take a miracle. And we know that. So we ask for that, oh God. Be with our country, oh God, as we seem so very divided right now. Help us to remember what's really important. Thank you, oh God, for those who are here, for every one of them. Thank you for our fathers and our grandfathers and our uncles and all of those men in our lives who have formed and shaped us and have been role models. All of these things, oh God, we ask in the name of your Son, our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today's reading is from Luke chapter 8, verse 26 through 39. It's in the New Testament. Then they arrived at the country of the Gerasenes, which is opposite Galilee. As they stepped out on the land, a man of the city who had demons met them. For a long time he had worn no clothes, and he did not live in a house but in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he fell down before him and shouted out at the top of his voice, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me." For Jesus had commanded the unclean spirits to come out of the man. For many times it had seized him, he was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles. But he would break the bonds and be driven by demons into the wilds. Jesus then asked him, "What is your name?" He said, "Legion, for many demons have entered him." They begged him not to order them to go back to the abyss. Now there on the hillside, a large herd of swine was feeding, and the demons begged Jesus to let them enter these. So he gave them permission. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When the swineherd saw what had happened, they ran off and told it in the city and in the country. Then they came out to see what had happened, and when they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had been sitting at the foot of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Those who had seen it told them how the one who had been possessed by demons had been healed. Then all the people of the surrounding countries of Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, for they were seized with great fear. So he got into the boat and returned. The man from whom the demons had gone begged that he might go with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." So he went away, proclaiming throughout the city how much Jesus had done for him. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we say, thanks be to God.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Put the Bible down here where it can be guarded by... Keep my pew warm. Friends, won't you pray with me? Holy God, we thank you for your power. We thank you for the Spirit that lives within each of us. That Spirit that has power to overcome demons in our lives. And though we don't like to think about it in that way, we know that there are demons that we struggle with. And so, Lord, be with us as we meditate this morning on your word. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, because you, O God, are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Some of you might remember, if you're my age or maybe even older, in 1966, a Gothic soap opera debuted called Dark Shadows. Anybody remember that? This really creepy scene. It was always foggy and kind of eerie, and this creepy music. And my brother and I would watch, peering from behind the door frames into the living room where our one and only television lived. And my mother used to laugh in later years and tell how we would go around the house and turn all the lights on because we were afraid. I don't know why we watched it, if it scared us so, but we did. And this week I went on YouTube and watched an episode and just laughed, because it is so goofy. But it was so real to us as little children. Today there are all kinds of other truly scary shows that are on, and I don't particularly understand the obsession of our culture today with all these shows like The Walking Dead. Zombies? Really? One of you that really likes that will have to enlighten me later. I see some of the younger going, uh-huh. The Vampire Diaries. Anybody like that one? Okay, don't raise your hand. All right. Supernatural. Oh, I see a hand back there. Supernatural, okay. I don't know anything about these shows other than I Googled scary TV shows. And I see them advertised. And I go, man, why would anybody watch that stuff? Wade and I are not big TV watchers, but there's also some movies that are out right now called Paranormal Activity. I'm not going to go see that. I don't enjoy being scared. I don't know what that's about. The Forest? Nobody's seen that one. Alice D? That just sounds creepy. But our culture is obsessed with that sort of thing, and I'm not really sure why, except maybe it stimulates our curiosity about evil in ways that we don't feel like we can talk about. And so we hide that little obsession by watching TV shows and going to scary movies. Evil intrigues us, doesn't it? It intrigues us because we don't understand it. It intrigues us in ways that we don't want to admit, we don't want to discuss, we don't want to talk about, we don't even want to think about it. We know that it exists in our world, but we want to keep it in that closet and keep the door closed where it can't get out. If we don't talk about it, it'll go away. Well, friends, that's naive. Because there is evil in our world. And our faith demands that we not only talk about it, but we stare it down and we face it through the power of Jesus Christ. We can do that. In this morning's gospel lesson, we see a story about demons, and I need to tell you, I didn't pick this scripture for Father's Day of all times. This is a lectionary text that just came up on the calendar, and yet I think it's apropos for us anytime as we think about those things in our life that seek to come against us. And this morning in our lesson, we see these narratives focusing on the culture of that day, back in antiquity, when in the Bible we hear about the Jewish tradition and all of the things they did, and they were so stern and so strict, and piety was so very important to them. And so in this lesson this morning, we see at least three elements of fear and danger to that piety. One was pigs. You see the herd of pigs. Pigs were the personification of uncleanness. You didn't get near a pig if you were Jewish in that culture. You steered clear of them as if they were a monster. Tombs were very scary. They still are today, aren't they? They're a source of uncleanness. So much so that back in that culture, sometimes families were known to whitewash the tombs because they didn't want anyone to get near them. And maybe if they were whitewashed, people would be able to stay a little farther away from them. And so tombs were this huge thing that they were afraid of. And then another image we see in this lesson this morning is the man who has no clothes on. He's naked. And it's not really a thing of evil as much as it just is illness and shamefulness and outcast. He behaved unlike anyone else in the community, and no one knew what to do with him. And so we see these three things, pigs and tombs and a naked man. Fearful images, unclean images that were to be avoided at all costs. It's hard to hear this story with the years that we have today in 2016. We'd understand it better if that naked man was in the cemetery on a primetime TV show, like one of those I talked about a minute ago that I can't remember, Supernatural, or The Walking Dead, walking around in a cemetery. But then it would be fiction, and we really wouldn't have to deal with it, because at the end of the show, we turned the TV off, right? But the reality is we cannot turn off those things that seek to come against us. Because in real life, in the culture of biblical times, they looked at this man and they thought maybe there was something seriously wrong with him, and there was. Maybe he was just mentally ill. And if they labeled him mentally ill, then at least that would justify the behavior. At least then they would know what caused it. In that case, we might see Jesus just perform a healing miracle and it would be all over. And his afflictions would go away, those afflictions that we see in verse 30 when Jesus calls him out and says, "What is your name?" And his answer is legion, for many demons had entered him. Legion. Now, no matter what ears we have, 2016 or the first century, no matter what commentary we read, no matter what Bible version we have, we read about this and we understand that the bottom line in this story is really not about healing. The bottom line in this story is not about uncleanness. It's about confronting demons and evil that seeks to come against people. Those evil things that we're afraid of. We have to name it because that is what it is. Just as we see these TV shows we see this story called the Gerasene demoniac. And it's a scary story for us. He is a demon, after all. He's a first century monster, so to speak. That's kind of like what we see on TV now. But he has nothing in common with that other people that lived in the community, the district of Gerasene. Everybody looked at him like he was a freak, for lack of a better word. And so where did they keep him? Out on the edge of the village in the cemetery. And if he was out there, they didn't have to deal with him. He just stayed out there. He spent his days ranting and raving and living in the tombs amongst the dead. What kind of sane person does that? The people in the village had kept him in the cemetery. And we don't know much about the location of the Gerasene area, but we know that Jesus arrived there by boat. The scripture tells us it was probably across the sea from Galilee. We don't read much about this area in the Bible. But verse 27 tells us that no sooner had Jesus arrived than he encountered the man who had demons, and he had been ill for a long time. The story implies that in order to protect himself, and obviously other people as well, they would bind him in chains, and he would be bound in the chains, but then he would become so violent and so crazy that he would break the bonds. Can you imagine someone having that kind of strength? He did. Now, friends, in our humanity, when someone's coming to visit, what do we want to do? We want everything to look really nice. We mow the yard, we clean the house. We want everything to look great and normal and spotless. And so what did the people in Gerasene do? They made sure this guy stayed in the cemetery. Jesus is coming, and we don't want Jesus to see this guy. And so we're going to keep him out in the cemetery. Well, that didn't work, did it? In the story, we see that kind of unraveled pretty quickly. The people in the village weren't prepared. Neither was the man. And that is why in verse 28, we hear that crazy man say, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you not to torment me." What have you to do with me, Jesus? Then he recognizes Son of the Most High God. He knows who he is. And he begs not to be tormented. Clearly, the demons within the man felt threatened by the very presence of Jesus. They knew there was some power there that they'd never seen, they'd never encountered. Jesus was prepared. And he knew how to handle the situation. And he did that by naming the demon, by calling him out, giving him control by saying, "What is your name?" When he said, "What is your name?" he called the demon out, and the demon no longer had power. And that's when he answers about legion, for many demons had entered him. And the biblical understanding of the word legion is a Roman military unit that could be as many as 6,000 troops. Friends, that's a lot of people. That's a lot of men. And if you have that vision in your mind of a militia of troops of 6,000, the implication for us this morning is that Jesus had more strength than 6,000 men. He could control this man. Brothers and sisters, what an incredible story. What a powerful story. When the demons heard Jesus calling them out, they were terrified. "Don't torment me." Remember that? They begged him not to send them into the abyss. And so there happened to be a herd of pigs standing nearby. Now, isn't that interesting in the Jewish culture that there would be this herd of pigs that they tried to stay away from because they were not good either? And so they begged him, and Jesus finally agreed to let the demons enter the pigs. And we read in this lesson that the entire herd then rushed down a steep bank into the lake, and they were drowned. Now, can you imagine the reaction of those who witnessed that event? I mean, think how you would have felt if you had been standing there and you'd seen this wild show that just happened in front of your eyes. Folks, this isn't on TV. This isn't something you can turn off. They were standing right there. Can you imagine? We're told in verse 34 that the swineherd saw what happened and they ran off and told it in the city and the country. They ran off. Can you imagine hearing what they might have said? You're not going to believe what just happened. And then they proceeded to tell their story with great drama. The people of the Gerasene district became afraid. Because clearly here was this man who had this amazing power to cast demons into a herd of pigs. And they were afraid of Jesus. They were afraid of his power. They were afraid of his strength. And so what did they do? They showed Jesus the door. They said, "Jesus, nice to see you. You can leave now." It's the Ellen version. "You can leave now." They were afraid of his power. They didn't know what to do with that. They'd never seen such a human show of power. Now remember, while this is happening, the crazy naked man is standing there fully clothed and normal. This man that many had known their entire life as being crazy and naked and running around, bursting out of his chains, there he was, very clearly healed, very clearly restored. The exorcism had occurred. What did Jesus tell him? "Return to your home and declare how much God has done for you." And he did just that. Now, if we go back and review just briefly in verse 28, this man said, "What? What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" He recognized he was the Son of the Most High God, and he fell before him and said, "What are you going to do to me?" He yielded his strength and his power to Jesus. Brothers and sisters, this morning I want to pose that question to you. What are we to do with those things in our life that have power over us, like the demons that we face, that we struggle with? What are we to do with all of that? We have to name it. We have to call it what it is. And call it out of the inner dark crevices of our soul and our spirit, so that Jesus can then restore us, so that healing can take place. We have to declare, and people will think you're crazy, but you know Scripture tells us that if there is something coming against you that is not of God, you have the power through the Holy Spirit to say, "In the name of Jesus Christ, I cast you out. You have no place with me." What is it? Well, I don't know. You tell me. Is it addiction? Is it grief? Lingering grief that just doesn't leave? What is it for you? Is it dishonesty? Is it fear, perhaps an irrational fear, and you're not able to do things that you should be able to do? Is it secrecy? Is it greed? What is that thing or those things that you need to call out and say, "In the name of Jesus Christ, I cast you out. You have no place with me. I am a child of God." My friends, we all have those things, and we need those things to be cast out so that we can step out on a path of healing and strength and recovery. And the good news is we don't have to peek around the door facings afraid of what we might see, because we know what's there. It's God Almighty, and he's standing there waiting for us. He's waiting for us to muster the strength within us. Because you know what? If we call it out in the name of Jesus Christ, the bonds that have held us tightly, whether it's addiction or illness or whatever it is, will be broken. And guess what? We will be free. You have that power by calling upon the name of Jesus Christ. Because that man Jesus is the great liberator of our sins, of our death, of the power of evil over us in our lives. And I don't know what the it is for you, but it's something Jesus can take care of. It's something that can be pulled from you. And then, what do? Then we have to go and proclaim to the city and to the country all that Jesus has done for us. And to say, "I struggle with this burden, but I don't have it anymore, because it's gone. By the power of Jesus Christ, I have been liberated. from whatever that is. It's not easy to face down our demons. I'm not saying it is. I am saying we have the power to do it because of Jesus Christ. And we can do it every day and twice on Sunday, as I like to say. We're not alone. We have the strength of Jesus to walk beside us and to guide us and to help us have the strength and to muster the courage to do what we know we have to do. Brothers and sisters, claim that scripture, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Can you say that with me? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving and mighty God, we thank you so much that you give us strength that we do not have. That you help us to call upon and to claim the strength that you give us. Thank you, O God, for walking with us and helping us to stare down our demons and to cast them out, knowing that you are our God and we are your children. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we close our service, we're going to sing a great hymn called Wonderful Words of Life. And as we sing that hymn, let me invite you to stand as you're able. And if there are those who would unite with our church family, we would invite them to come forward as we sing. And sisters, we do have a reception planned for our Vacation Bible School folks and for anyone who wants to go to the fellowship hall at this time and meet and greet and celebrate Father's Day or whatever it is you want to do to celebrate God's goodness in your life. Those things are set up in the fellowship hall and they're looking forward to seeing you down there. So let me invite you on your way out to grab a cookie just to stave off the hunger before you get to the restaurant. Okay? Brothers and sisters, we thank God so much for the strength he gives us in times when we don't have strength on our own. You've all been there. I know I have. And we know that God gives us that strength because he loves us so much. So claim those things. Claim that power within you and know that God desires only good for you and not evil. In Christ's name we pray.